One of the nice things about the ABCD study is that it's a what's called a non-clinical sample. So it's a general population sample. And sometimes if you study a clinical population, the participants that you're working with can be biased by who's going to clinics versus who are not, who's not going to a clinic, which sometimes plays a role, particularly for girls with ADHD who are less likely to get referred to treatment. So we were able to look at ADHD without that sort of sampling bias. And we really did expect to see differences in girls versus boys. And to our surprise, we did not see that. It's critically important to be studying ADHD in girls for a number of reasons. First and foremost, ADHD in girls is really understudied. So it's more common in boys, and so it's been studied much more in boys, but there are still many, many girls and women who have ADHD and struggle with the condition. And if we're gonna be able to provide the best possible treatments to them, we need to be studying ADHD in girls. That's the most important reason. And then another sort of scientific reason is what I had mentioned before, that ADHD is a very heterogeneous disorder. And for us to really be able to make progress in understanding the biology of ADHD, we need to be able to define more homogeneous biological types. And one way to do that is to look at, you know, clear differences. So to look at differences in boys with ADHD versus girls with ADHD. Other ways that you could do that are to look at, you know, for example, kids with ADHD who have a strong family history of ADHD versus those who don't. All of those things might be ways for us to define more homogeneous subpopulations. I think where the field really needs to continue to move is to looking at large populations and using new and innovative imaging techniques. So in our study, we looked strictly at what's called structural MRI, looking at, you know, size and shapes of brain regions. But it's also possible to look at how the brain is wired. So what we call white matter tracts that connect different brain regions can give you a very different perspective on the brain. And looking at brain function. So how does the brain activate, become engaged in various tasks, which also can give you a distinct lens on ADHD. And you know, another important avenue of investigation is looking earlier in development. So if we can, if we study adults, for example, if you study an adult with ADHD, it's oftentimes difficult to tease apart whether you're looking at the biology of ADHD per se, or if you're looking at the effects of ADHD on the brain. And differentiating those two can be quite difficult. If we are able to study earlier in development, and I mean studying infants and even studying the fetal brain, that can give us a perspective on the earliest roots of ADHD without the confounding effect of adaptation, for example.